But thanks so much for coming here. Thanks for Tribeca and Nitehawk for screening this. It's so terrific to see so many people here. Hey, how's it going? How are you guys doing? It's and see friends and whatnot here. So it's an honor to be here. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's a great space to screen in. And, you know, we're looking at a Brooklyn movie tonight. So it's perfect. We're going to open up a Q&A in a minute, but I just wanted to talk to you guys a little bit about the film. I had the luck of being able to do the Q&A for the world premiere of the film earlier this year at Tribeca Film Festival, where I think we did have maybe about 40 people from the film were there, which was amazing, and I think they all participated in the Q&A as well.
I always have a hard time with opening night films when you have your like home group of people there, because I don't trust the laughter. I think they're all just laughing obligatory. Even when, you know, there's a lot of friends in the audience too, so I feel like I wouldn't be able to sit in this audience and trust it, because I think they're just laughing because they know me and they want to be supportive. So it's best when you go to a festival where you don't know anyone, or you go, I was in Paris recently and showed the movie, and that's fun to watch because then you know you've really earned the laughter. But then at the same time, though, I still don't sit in the audience because I'm too nervous. You like to sit and watch the movie, right? And with the audience.
Yeah, like, I like to see, you know.
See your performance and whatnot? Or
the whole thing. I like to see how it plays.
Yeah.
You know, different audiences on a different night.
Do you like watching? Do you mind if I ask?
Not at all.
Do you like watching your, or do you get like, when you watch it the first time, do you get like troubled by like watching yourself and have a hard time watching it objectively because you're focused on yourself? Or
yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's not enjoyable, and it's probably not realistic what you're seeing. You're too negative about it, maybe, or I'm too negative about it. And then you watch it a few more times, and you calm down a little bit about it.
Yeah,
you get used to seeing, you know, yourself.
Yeah. I was nervous working with Max because Max has been working for 25, 30 years, and also in the last 4 years, he's worked with Martin Scorsese, Woody Allen, the Coen brothers, and I was just like, oh my God, I just was terrified working with you. And I learned more about the script and more about the movie working with you. I mean, you knew more about the script than I did. I just
read it a lot.
I know, I learned about understanding like the motivations of your actors and actually what's in their heads and whatnot, because I'll bang a script out and revise it. I'll revise a lot, but I don't really think too much about, you know, what's really going on, because I kind of like don't have a vision for the movie. We just kind of throw everyone in it and just say, let's see what happens for me, you know? And that part of that is by being in the movie, like I'm in the middle of it, so I'm being dictated by producers and by... It's a tiny crew, so everybody you saw was giving feedback. You know, you have...
Yeah, it was a little too...
It was chaotic.
needed a dictator.
It seems like that would be hard for a film like this in particular, because you play around with tone so much and it's switching so much. I mean, you were talking earlier about the crowd reaction, and you get every crowd reaction throughout this film. You know, you get cringes, you get laughter, you get all of these things. Because this is a question for both of you guys, you know. I mean, I know that it's hard as you're directing the scene and as you're acting in the scene, and Max, you as an actor, like, how did you guys keep track of what you were bringing to the scene? Because, you know, there are some things that are laugh out loud funny, and there are other things that are really quite dark and sad or scary.
I've had people criticize the fact that my tones for all my movies are all over the place. I think it's just a deficiency in my ability to write something that kind of, and maybe the fact that I've got some kind of bipolar disorder or personality disorder or something. But it's like, it's my stuff's all over the place. But one of the luxuries, some would call it a luxury, some would call it a deficit as well, is that we would shoot maybe 3 or 4 days and have three or four days off to kind of figure out what we're going to shoot for the following week, because we didn't have a lot of pre-production time going into the film, because I thought the movie was going to be taken away. I thought the funding was going to be removed. That happens. Have you been on projects where you thought a movie was going to happen in the project?
Yeah. And then you wanted to cut everything out. You're going to do it, you know, you lost all the money, and then you're going to do, okay, we're going to do it one day. We're going to cut out everything. And I hated that because I loved what you wrote. And I actually didn't want to ad lib anything. I thought like what you wrote was really, what I responded to was great. I didn't want to change anything. And then we got in on set, and everything got like totally kind of thrown up in
the air. Well, you know, we wouldn't rehearse too much, but you would hear all the dialogue, and it's like hearing it is much different than seeing it on the page. And I think we would make, you know, changes and revisions. And at first, you know, Max would kind of protest and say, the script, what's great, it's great what's written. But then we would open it up and let it be a little more.
You were right. It definitely was better, like to ad lib a little bit. And
I was shocked because you said that if you don't mind if I get fanny, I get like a fanboy for a second. But Scorsese likes to improv. I mean, I'm not comparing. I mean, of course, there's nothing like. But you said he'll come with the script and then he will just say forget all the script and just kind of improv.
He likes to improvise a lot.
Max is on the show right now. It was called Rock and Roll. Can I say this? I can talk about this, right? It's called Vinyl. It's a show they're shooting in HBO right now. You're playing. What do you play on that show?
I play the head of the A&R department. It's a fictitious record label.
I heard some people.
American Century Records. It's 1973, New York.
How's it?
It's a rock label. Bobby Cannavale is the president of the label, and Ray Romano is a promotions man. I'm head of A&R. And
when does that premiere? Do you know yet?
January.
All right.
How many episodes have they shot already?
We're shooting right now number 7 out of 10.
How's production going? Is it going well?
It's going very good. Yeah. Very good.
Hey, Scorsese directed it?
He directed the pilot, right?
Yeah. Who are the directors of some of the other episodes?
There's some HBO regular, like Alan Coulter, people like that.
I'm more interested in that than Applesauce.
I see where you're going, Onur.
I tell you, it was really exciting because I've known of Max's work for a long time and had seen him in some of his recent works. And you were on Broadway for a while and whatnot. So you, season
talk about the film.
Okay, we can talk about the film too. But this is about the film too, because when we sent your manager the script, you read it the first night and then you met with me for lunch and it gave me you can't make movies without confidence, and I'm very insecure about a lot of things. But you have to have people who believe in you, and you gave me so much confidence in that first meeting.
I loved it.
I'm
usually, if I'm offered anything, I automatically assume it's got to be because it's a piece of shit. So when I read it and was just knocked out by how funny and smart and dark it was, and I'd never get offered something that good.
But I immediately said,
give me the guy. I was on the phone with you that night, right, and I met you the next day.
That's awesome.
And that was terrific. And I think playing the leading role,
I get to play a real person with a wife and marital problems and like a real person, and instead of, maybe gangsters.
I think it was great to see you fleshed out in this way,
a normal person,
as an actor, and it's funny how you even bring a little bit of that in the beginning, where when you're really angry with him, you bring that so people that might have seen you in other things before, you bring a little bit of I know the Sicilian mafia,
we put that in there just to play with that truth a little bit, just to kind of wink at the Sopranos and the fact that Boardwalk Empire, you kind of played the heavy in those, and it was nice having you play a real person. I take credit for giving Max his first sex scene that he's ever had in a movie, and it was
can we,
yeah,
can
it was
we get a hand for that Max's first
and
sex
that was
scene?
A lot of fun. You were so excited. There was two times where Max was really adorable, and they could be further on the spectrum. Is Emmy Harrington here too right now? Emmy, come up here. Emmy's in the movie. Emmy was she played one of the girls in Orange's The New Black, the TV show, and she's amazing. The TV show Life in Orange, and she's amazing. I could talk about that as well. But there was two times where Max was so happy, was doing the sex scene, and then then on the other end of the spectrum where he's just a proud father, the two little girls who find the finger, that's his family. That's his that's his two daughters and his wife. And I remember we were shooting that scene. You were behind the camera, just so proud, saying, "She's doing great. She's just doing
a great
job." And then after the sex scene, he'd go to me and say, "How did I do that? Was I sexy? Did I look good?" He didn't say.
Let me look good. Make me look good.
So it was a lot of fun. We had a good time. But I was nervous. I was very, especially as an actor. Like, I'm not an actor. I perform my own personality. What you see right now is what I am in the movie. But
you were better to work with as a director on the days that you weren't acting.
Yeah, I feel like those
days you were acting, you were a pain in the ass.
Pain in the ass. Right.
We need some behind the scenes footage there, maybe. Right. Yeah.
But it was fun. But yeah, so cool.
So your daughters were in there in that little piece. I mean, what I also really noticed about it is there's an amazing ensemble here. I mean, you have the core ensemble of the two couples, but then around you have such a realistic cross section of New York. And I wanted to see if you could talk a little bit about that and how you brought all of those people together. I mean, I think you have some actors, some non-actors, and you have them kind of all mixed up.
What do you think? I mean, I've only lived in New York about 4.5 years, and for me, it was really important to to get people of color in the movie as much as I could. That for me, that was like, I feel like New York is amazing because it's such a diverse, you know,
absolutely,
you know,
yeah,
such a diverse city. That's one of the reasons why it's so amazing. So for me, I mean, I don't know how to make a New York film because I'm not a New Yorker. Just based on trying to write dialogue, based on the fact that I'm influenced by Woody Allen, Neil LaBute, you know, New York kind of quintessential directors. I don't know. I don't think in terms of making a New York film, but I do know that I probably wouldn't have thought so much about diversity if I'd been making the film in North Carolina, you know what I mean? And it's a matter of like, how do I get people, you know, of different races in other roles? The one thing I feel might touch on racism a little bit is the Asian role where, you know, he kills the cat and whatnot. He just seems like the bad guy. And there's a scene that we actually shot where after he makes the phone call at the end of the movie to the radio station guy, we shoot a scene where he goes upstairs and actually has a nice dinner with his family. He's got his wife and he's got his daughter, and it's a really, really beautiful moment. It's all in Mandarin. It's subtitled, and they're talking about opening up a new restaurant and how New York is so amazing and how they're going to make a new restaurant better than ever. But you know, the movie has like 4 endings already, right? And it just already gave it another ending, so I couldn't put it in there. So for me, like, I'd love to, a dream to make a movie that's even extremely diverse, that has, yeah, you know, people of all different, you know, diversity.
I definitely appreciated the diversity, and I think it's hard to make. I mean, how can you really make a true New York film without that? So
yeah, I think so. I mean, I'd like to, you know, I'm lucky. I live in Bushwick, where it's gentrifying, but not that fast. And there's still just kind of an edge and a rawness to where I live that really feels like the New York that I imagined, like in the 80s or 90s, that, you know, that wasn't so just clean. And I mean, not that it's still clean, but it's like, it's got an edge to it that's really, really nice and gnarly and graffiti. And like, it's just, you know, it's lower class, middle class. It's just not so, I don't want to say hipster, because I get labeled that all the time. I don't really quite know what a hipster is, really. Although I'm reading a book right now called The Other Serious that breaks down what the whole hipster idea. Anyway, I don't want to go into that. I'm very excited. Just being in New York is inspiring, to be making movies on the streets, in restaurants. To me, like, I've always looked at New York as an outsider in North Carolina, dreaming of being here making movies, and these cameras and be able to make a movie with a smaller crew now allows you to do that. You know, and to me, it's just, you know, it's exciting and inspiring to be here.
You definitely feel the energy on screen.